experience of farmer who is growing BT.
Hello.
And in India for many years, Mr. Govind Joshi.
So I have been invited here for this talk.
Name?
I am Ashutosh Murkute.
Thank you.
Friends and participants, I first of all express my sincere thanks to the conveners for having given me an opportunity to participate in this debate. I am a farmer from Parbhani, where Honorable Meiser had served as a Vice Chancellor for few years and Professor for 25 years. It's a cotton, rather 80% of the land, it is occupied by the cotton, at least since the inception of this BT cotton. We grow cotton, we used to grow cotton in deep black soils. I mean the water holding capacity of the soils with good water holding capacity. Those were identified as deep black cotton soil. Deep black cotton soil. Cotton was associated with this kind of, we had been using this such kind of, deep black cotton soils for cultivating the cotton. But now since the inception of this BT cotton, people have started growing this cotton even on shallow type of soils, where the soils are not, the soils which have a lesser water retention capacity. Means the very objection or observation that has been raised that cotton is a irrigated crop and not a dry land crop. This is a very simple, the people, the farmers, they have replaced our previous pearl millet or bajra, what you call them. Previously we used to grow on lighter kind of soils. Now the people, they are growing cotton there, this BT cotton. This eliminates the rather very objection or this I mean observation that BT cotton can be grown as a only a irrigated crop. No doubt any crop under irrigation gives a better result. It's not a BT cotton alone. Some people say that there is no direct impact of this BT gene on the productivity of this cotton, but certainly, though indirect, but it is a substantial rather growth in productivity that has come because of this insect resistance trait, the only trait that has been introduced with this conventional cotton crop. Now, another thing that the people, the objection that is that has been raised, that it has ceased to be it has ceased to produce better as it was producing some 5 years back, sir. But I think it has to do something with the hybrid vigor of that crop. It has not anything to do with this BT character. This character has to be corrected rather by the conventional breeders rather, who have brought this hybrid in being. Then again, there is the infestation of secondary pest that has grown, but it has something to do with the people growing cotton after cotton on the same soils, and this also has happened because people, they don't find any good alternative. They have found this comparative advantage with this BT cotton with all another crops. If there comes any good variety out of this, by any means, or conventional, hybridization or this biotechnology, people certainly will go for this, crop rotation. Now, the crop rotation, the tradition which was followed, has ceased to be in vogue since last 10-15 years. There are many reasons. The one reason I just told you that in our area, at least, we don't have another alternative crop, rather which can be substituted to this cotton at present time in this context or in this situation. Another reason is that the size of holding that has become very uneconomic. These are the most of the farmers in our area. They just hold below 1 hectare land. It's not rather viable, it's not possible for them to rotate with different crops in such a small size of land. Then again, it's the suicides of the farmers, those are the normally, I mean the opponents, they are linking these suicides with the adoption of this BT cotton. But if, in my opinion, it's the lingering effect of the people having been denied with, the farmers having been denied with the remunerative prices for since long, and it's with their economics, this BT cotton alone is not a panacea, it's not a Ramban, that this alone it will solve the, all the problems and people will come out of their distresses, and this is not, I don't think it is associated with this, we can go for the discussions later on. But at this moment, I can just tell that it doesn't have anything to do with this, I mean, BT cotton. Health and environment, I think I should not go for the technical details. There are a lot of people who can throw much more better light on that, on those factors.
Did you tell that you are already there growing BT cotton for so long?
Yeah.
So, aapko kuch health ka impact
aaya? No.
Aapke family ke
upar? We are using this as a food and feed,
yeah,
in the form of food as a cottonseed oil and feed as a this cottonseed cake. But I don't know. On the contrary, another observation that was from the Andhra Pradesh, I think some people pointed out that this sheep and goats, I mean this, the feeding on this harvested field of this cotton, there had been a lot of mortality. Nothing of that sort, because in our Parbhani or in Maharashtra, after the total harvest is over, in numbers I should say, a lot of herds from all over the country, all over the India, they come for grazing there on our fields. But there is no such type of, no any kind of complaint, not the herd owners. On behalf of the sheep and goat, they have not so far complained that such kind of mortality has taken place. If any questions you can ask about on what?
Before we start the next, the company which started this BT cotton, Monsanto, we would like to have Shilpa come at to make comments in relation to the introduction and relating to the farming community.
So I'll just talk about a little bit the history of how we brought the technology together with Mahiko into the country. What options were in front of us when the technology was brought into the country? What options were chosen to actually take the technology to the market at that point in time? And what the experience has been, much of which has been spoken about. So Monsanto had discovered the fact that this application exists, and we were the ones who in other countries had started experiments and trials. India being such a large cotton growing geography, it was felt, and the bollworm being such a big pest which caused a huge yield drag, it was felt that this is another country and the farmers of this country could benefit from this technology. Monsanto came into India in 1949. The technology was introduced in the country in 2002. What I'm trying to say is that we did not come into the country in 2000 and bring the technology in 2002. As a company, we have been present here. This is our 66th year of existence. Our first product in agriculture was registered in 1975, which was actually a rice herbicide. So this year we are celebrating 40 years in Indian agriculture. And the cotton technology that is being spoken about was actually introduced in 2002. So we have been in the country researching, trying to understand the needs of Indian farmers much before the first technology was introduced, and we've had other applications and other products in the agricultural space as well. We formed a joint venture with Mahiko because Mahiko at that point in time and even today is a seed company. So what they develop is a cotton seed, and this technology needed a carrier in the form of the cotton seed for it to actually express in the field. So for us to be able to conduct trials, we needed a partner with whom we could actually put the technology together, and that could then go into trials out there in the field. While we were doing this, the initial idea was to actually do this with the ICAR. And I think there were conversations that took place to offer this technology to the Indian Council of Agricultural Research. For whatever be the reasons at that point in time, the Indian Council of Agricultural Research was not interested in actually furthering this partnership or even entering into this partnership. Considering the benefits that the technology would give to Indian farmers, it was then thought that there are several Indian cotton seed companies, and there are numerous of them. Rather than going to the top 5 or 10 companies which had the best hybrid seeds or which had the largest market share, we will provide this technology to all the cotton seed companies who are focused on research and development in seed, because this technology has to be carried on the seed. So as things stand today, after the trials were done, we got the approvals and the technology was introduced in 2002. That was the single gene, and then the next approval was got in 2006, and that's when the Bolgard 2, which is the double gene, and Dr. Narayanan or somebody can explain the specifics of that through the rest of the day, was introduced in 2006. There are 6 genes which are approved in the Indian context in cotton. Only 2 of those are Monsanto's. But farmers understand the efficacy of genes, and it so happens that the Mahiko Monsanto joint venture has these approvals, and that is the seeds with this technology are actually the ones that are getting planted out there. Okay, so that's just a little bit of a background. Today we have 46 cotton seed companies, including some state seed corporations, to whom this technology is licensed. So it is not 1 or 2 or 3 companies, it is widely licensed. We have a lot of applications which are pending, which we review. We also want to make sure that the technology is licensed to companies which are research and development focused companies, because like Joshi Saab said, the ability of a plant to provide yield is not just the technology, it is also the genetic potential of the plant. So companies such as these, Metahelix, several others, Bioseed, and many of our other partners actually have very focused R&D efforts to continue to develop the seed itself. And we want to partner with such companies because then they continue to bring out newer and newer hybrids which meet the needs of the farmers, the evolving needs of the farmers. So that's sort of the background. Just one last thing I will say is there is a feeling that it means that we can hold back availability of cotton seed or we can make it available in a certain year. The way this licensing works is there is a gene, as you said. The gene is now available with all the cotton seed licensees of this joint venture company, which means they have the seeds which have the gene. They decide how much of that seed to produce. Seed production happens every year. So right now, actually, all these cotton seed companies would be harvesting from the field the cotton seed, which will then get processed and packed to be given to the farmer. Monsanto does not produce the seed and does not decide how much cotton seed will be made available to the Indian farmers for next year. There are several companies out there who know what the demand for their hybrids is going to be because of the performance of the hybrids. And they decide 1 year in advance ki humne naya variety, humne naya hybrid introduce kiya hai, isse water stress ki shamta badh jayegi, farmer prefer karega, ya sucking pest ki shamta isme achhi hai tolerance ki. They decide ki hum 4 million packet banayenge agle saal ke liye. They would have already planted, they will now be processing it, and that will be made available in the market. So this is just a brief clarification. I know there are discussions on royalty and pricing towards the end of the day, so I don't want to preempt that conversation. But we've been here in the country long enough. This product was brought in with Mahiko because we needed a seed partner, an Indian company who could also partner with us to further enhance our understanding. We've been here longer than the technology has been here. We do things other than biotechnology in the country. It is not just biotechnology. We have people out there in the field who work in the fields of India. I have a 1,000 member team in this country and 5,000 to 6,000 temporary people, seasonal people from the villages who work in this country who understand what Indian agriculture needs. So we are as Indian can be. And I know there is a big debate around US and American, and I'm happy to answer all those questions. But all of us in this company are Indian. We work for the Indian farmers, and we believe we bring the right products. We are happy to discuss experiences and happy to share any other responses to any queries you might have. That's the objective of being here.
मैं ये पूछना चाहूँगा कि जैसे अभी जो technical presentation हुआ, तो उसमें bollworm को control करने के लिए technology आ रही है. तो क्या इसमें resistance develop होता है या नहीं होता है?
Yes.
क्या ये फुल प्रूफ टेक्नोलॉजी है?
No technology is foolproof. There will be new developments. Every technology, even if you take car or your cell phone or anything like that, you know, there will be new needs and new challenges to be overcome. Even if you take conventional breeding varieties, there has been at one time, there were a lot of varieties. If you take cotton Narasimha and other varieties, now you have got hybrid, so it has to continuously evolve. Even in pesticides. Now, even in pesticides, many pesticides have become, insects have overcome the act of the pesticides. Now, resistance can develop. So, like you have changes in the genetics of the plant, when there is a pressure on the insect, that is also a living organism, that also can change. And that is the reason why, when scientists deploy that technology, they develop many mechanisms by which you delay the development of resistance so that the longevity of the technology or the benefit of the technology can be realized to the maximum extent. One example is the provision of refugia. I'm sure all of you have bought, or at least some of you have bought BT cotton seed packet. In that BT cotton seed packet, there will be 120 grams, in a 450 gram packet, 120 grams of non-BT seeds. That non-BT seeds essentially provides a refugia. Now, if you want to know the principles by which it will delay resistance, I will be more than happy to
do that.
Thank you. I'm not sure.
So what you are answering is there is a
It is
resistance.
Not necessary. We are all are aware about all that things.
But resistance can develop.
And to elaborate his question, resistance aapne observe kiya hai kya?
नहीं अभी
नहीं, हमारे सीज़ में तो ऑब्जर्व नहीं किया है
ऑब्जर्व नहीं किया वन मिनट ऑब्जर्व नहीं किया है आप कह रहे हैं तो मेरा मॉन्सेंटो से प्रश्न है
एक मिनट लेट क्वेश्चन
व्हाई दे आर डेवलपिंग दी बोल गार्ड फर्स्ट सेकंड थर्ड टू अदर थिंग्स व्हाई दे आर डेवलपिंग देन
इफ यू आर नॉट आई डोंट होल्ड अ ब्रीफ फॉर
मॉन्सेंटो वन जस्ट वेट दिस क्वेश्चन
दिस इज अबाउट नेचर सो रेजिस्टेंस हैपेंस If we take antibiotics, we are asked to complete a course of antibiotics because if you don't complete it, the next time you take it, your body will resist it if you don't go through the entire course. So it's a part of nature. There are many other scientists here who can explain it. So the fact that resistance could occur is known, which is why biotechnology, which is why the discovery process goes on. And if you have more genes which can offer that resistance or provide a broader spectrum, there could be newer ways of actually addressing the resistance that could be developing, right? So the fact is that resistance can develop. This is nature, it is evolution, and the biotechnology process therefore allows improvements to happen over a period of time by which you can actually continue to offer the same benefits that the plant offers, which is why Bolgard was replaced by Bolgard 2. So that's, you know, that's why the
thank you. Ashok, do you have any questions?
As a farmer, I can answer that we all agree and expect to evolve more effective, rather more competitive solutions. And that's what the Monsanto or any research people
thick,
are doing.
Thick. Ashok, tumcha prashna hai. Yeah, any question?
Just an observation about the resistance. I think resistance happens in anything. I think even pesticides. Even before like BT has come in. And there has been always been technologies that have tried to overcome those resistance as they keep happening. I think as has been said, resistance is a natural product. Okay? And technologies will develop. I mean, it's not producing one variety of BT cotton is the end of the end of the
Varia.
Technology evolution. I'd like to ask another question. One of the slides that I saw showed that the cotton particular production had come down from a peak. I mean, of course, then what has come down is still much higher than what it was before, before the introduction of the BT.
You see, the production almost peaked up to 2009-2010, and then it has slowed down. Okay. Now there are several reasons for that. Actually, the problem is that cotton production is not only the because of BT or anything. There are also environmental conditions under which it is. One major effect has come that the area in which cotton should not have been grown is being grown because of price, non-traditional area. And that is one major reason by which which basically, for example, in Vidarbha, I was surprised that in rice area cotton is being grown in Chandrapur. And in the lighter type of soil, so there is reduction. So the area, you will not believe, it is from 10 million hectares, it has come to 12.2 million hectares. 2 million hectare area has increased. And major area has come in the dry land area. That is the major problem. Otherwise, if you see Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan.
How do you explain the drop in the
average? Yeah, that is what is average has come down. But again, the average is almost 400. It has come touching 500.
One question to Bhai Varyala. Sir, 1 minute. Question Bhai Varyala.
I just want to comment on the statement that precautions are taken by putting seeds so that refugia are maintained. I think everybody here knows that the refugia are followed in absence. There are no refugia really being followed by farmers. So let's not put data which is wrong.
Let me explain on that point.
We have to explain this point.
We will. Nobody follows.
The concept comes along when you have hundreds of hectares of cotton being brought in and there is no other crop to sustain
host
other varieties to be as a host of Helicoverpa. About 180 different plants work as hosts of Helicoverpa. And in Indian conditions, when the land is so much fragmented, almost every other plant around the cotton field works as a refuge. And therefore, technically, if you want
natural
to say,
plants.
Yeah, naturally, there are 180 different plants which work as hosts of Helicoverpa. Second thing, when a scientist says that there is a possibility of developing resistance, he is talking about thousands and thousands of insects and one insect being resistant. Locating one resistant insect in a field. So he says that, yes, there is a possibility of development of resistance. But then he also has to say something else, that out of that one insect, it is very, very rare that this insect would survive. In resistant insects, this resistance trait dilutes out. When it is breeding with million other insects, it dilutes out. And virtually, again, one in a million, chance remains that it is.
That's why, sir, we are having a session on the risks.
So, that's why, when a common person thinks that scientists to bol rahe hain, resistance develop
hota hai. We are having a session on the risk.
Wait. Resistance to develop hota hai, scientist means that one in a million chance. And when a common man says that the resistance development hota hai, to iska matlab hota hai. So that's the difference.
Correct.
It's a biological
phenomenon. I would like to answer the question of Mr. Chowgule. The cotton has become a sort of a monoculture. And the monoculture meets the same kind of it, declining the productivity. Monoculture, I mean, the growing the cotton after cotton on the same soil. There must be rotation. But the rotation has ceased to be invoked since the last one decade. By Ali, they are told.
Mr. Ganesh.
I'll address not the science part, I'm not a scientist, but the kind of production and productivity. What Chowgule referred to is yield per hectare, which he explained. Now, last night I was just looking at the latest advisory from USDA on cotton. Now, according to them, India is now the world's largest producer in terms of production. Their forecast is 6 million tons out of total global expected production of close to about 26 million tons. China has now last out to India. Until 2 years ago, they were the number one. So ours will end up, we're close to 6 million tons. I'm not putting it in bales because US is million tons and China is 5.9. The advisory also says that the demand is going to be subdued and therefore that there will be less area planted in some of the leading countries, including India.
Yes.
So I thought I should clarify with the data that India has emerged as the leader by application of various technology. So in terms of production, yes, we are number one. In terms of productivity, that's a different thing altogether. Thank you.
But still the figures are there that we used to produce 399 kg of lint during the year 2003-04. 299 kg of lint, and now we are producing 550 kg of lint.
495. Anything you want to say? No.
I just want to add one sentence to you especially. It is already intercropping by Arhar. So there is no issue of monocropping. Arhar is already there, 20% Arhar they eat.
Yes,
sir. Can I?
Yeah, Mr. Gundren.
I just want to add one basic fact, because many times there is a confusion between varieties, hybrids, and GM seeds.
That's right.
So I just want to
clarify
that GM can be put into either varieties or hybrids. There is no differentiation there. So if it is in varieties, the farmer can save the seed. If it is in hybrid, the farmer has to buy the seed. So GM has nothing to do with the ability of the farmer to either save the seed or buy the seed. So I just want to clarify that.
Yeah,
that's good. A very popular misconception.
That's good.
Sir, can I?
Or that vigor.
Sir, just
for vigor, then
we
hybrid.
As a farmer, this again, prior to, or even after the inception of this hybrid cottons, we had not many varieties in Arboriums, Hirsutums, Barbadans, but people, they did not prefer the varieties. Because of this higher yield, they preferred hybrids. And then it's naturally that we have got to have a bit in the hybrids rather than these varieties.
Yes, Mr.
Friends, I am having a different question.
Yes.
BT cotton ke production ke baad Gujarat mein practically cotton ka revolution ho gaya. Jo cotton seed hai uski wajah se kapas ya tel ye khane mein aata hai. Yani jo genetically modified plant tha uska product ह्यूमन कंजम्पशन में बिल्कुल रेगुलरली आ रहा है, फीड में जा रहा है, फीड में केवल भेड़ और बकरी के उसमें जा रहा है ऐसा ही नहीं, तो औरों में भी जा रहा है, और उसके थ्रू भी ह्यूमन बीइंग में आ रहा है. इज देयर एनी डाटा अवेलेबल और कलेक्टेड और एनी एक्सपेरिमेंट डिजाइन दैट हाउ डज इट अफेक्ट द ह्यूमन हेल्थ? हमारी ह्यूमन हेल्थ में आज आप मेडिकल का डाटा देखें तो लोग बताएंगे कि हम डायबिटीज की राजधानी है दुनिया की, कुछ लोग बताएंगे कि हम ब्लड प्रेशर की दुनिया की राजधानी है, कुछ लोग बताएंगे कि हम आई की जो डिजीजेस हैं उसकी राजधानी है. सो मेनी डिजीजेस हैज एक्सप्लोडेड और इंक्रीज और आर सीन. डू दे हैव एनी कोरिलेशन विद द कपासिया तेल कंजम्पशन? I request the house that before making any wide comment, let us have some data on the effect of all these things on human health. And if you want to take any data on human health, I had suggested time and again that there should be a mixed team of doctors and agricultural scientists together who should study the case. I can give you one example what has happened. I was the Vice Chancellor of Anand Agriculture University. We were requested to conduct an experiment on BT brinjal. Experiment was conducted. At the time of conducting the experiment, hum hamesha jo experiment dene wala hota hai usse poochte hain ki objective kya hai, aap kya chahte ho, hum kya study karke aapko bataye. To unhone humse kaha tha ki hame aap do baaton mein study karke bataye ki brinjal ki yield badhti hai ya nahi, और दूसरी बात ये बताइए कि इसमें पर्टिकुलर ये जो पेस्ट है इसका इंसिडेंस कम हुआ या नहीं. और हमने कहा कि ठीक है, एक्सपेरिमेंट जो था वो हमारी यूनिवर्सिटी के फील्ड में हुआ, बिल्कुल कंट्रोल्ड एक्सपेरिमेंट हुआ, जैसा एग्रीकल्चर में हमारे एक्सपेरिमेंट्स होते हैं. डाटा लिया गया और हमारी फाइंडिंग आई कि हाँ, बीटी ब्रिंजल की यील्ड ज़्यादा है और पेस्ट इंसिडेंस कम है. ये जो दोनों फाइंडिंग थी, क्योंकि ये दो हमसे पूछी गई थी, हमने दोनों जो एक्सपेरिमेंट देने वाले थे उनको डिक्लेयर कर दी, बतला दी. और बाद में पेपर में न्यूज आई कि बीटी ब्रिंजल इज वेरी गुड फॉर ह्यूमन कंजम्पशन एंड गुड फॉर द प्रोडक्शन, एंड आनंद यूनिवर्सिटी हैज कंडक्टेड द एक्सपेरिमेंट एंड द रिजल्ट्स आर प्रूव्ड बाय द आनंद यूनिवर्सिटी दैट इट इज वेरी गुड फॉर ह्यूमन यूथ. my statement is that this paper news was given deliberately, but it was a total bogus news. Because we have not conducted any experiment on human consumption. Our experiment was on production and the pest resistance. We found that yes, production has increased, pest resistance has increased. But how the brinjal consumption will affect the human health, whether it is fit for human consumption, whether it is fit for animal consumption, was never studied. But it is coming with the advertisement in the paper news that yes, the experiment was conducted and it was found that it is very good. My request is that while we are discussing the seed production and its yield and the soils and the type of the soils, okay, everything finally it will affect your human health. So, do you have, the whole house who is present here, do you have any data on the effect of consumption of BT cotton seed oil on the health of human being and on the health of the animals?
Thank you, sir. One second, before we begin, we have a structured schedule. Please, we are going to have a risk. We are going to have a structured discussion. So we are having a presentation by Dr. Vashni in the next sessions. We are going to have question answers. My request is stick to the schedule. Let's have a tea first, collect all the data.
Who is actually using this technology in the world? And what portion of that production contributes to the global food production which we are consuming across the world? And how much of that portion actually come from GMO in terms of international trade, both in grain, then in oil, and in the meal, which is being consumed by oil, by the animals, and then it's being consumed by the human population. So there have been questions about utility and the safety of the technology over a long period of time. So I'm going to have this discussion about grain production contribution into oil and the meal. So first of all, we believe that biotechnology is important for achieving the target that are being set for the global population. For which the food has to be produced. As an international organization, we know that there are concerns on this technology which are being discussed in the morning hours. A lot of concerns about who produced this technology, whether it's a proprietary technology, where it's being consumed, what are the food feed safety issues. And there is a lot of knowledge deficit. Many people don't know about intricacies of using this technology and in terms of cultivation and productions. So we come out with the data set and produce report annually, which is being distributed widely across the world. And some portion of that data I'm going to present to you. If you look at the global scene, sir, 1.5 billion hectares being planted with different crops. 1.5 billion by half a billion farm families. How much you produce? You produce 2.5 billion tons out of 1.5 billion hectares. Out of this 2.5 billion, you have productions of maize, wheat, rice, and oilseed. And similarly, you have the production of tuber crops, pulses, and other fiber crops. Out of the 2.5 billion, close to 16% of that grain that are being produced is being traded. 14 million tons of the grains are being traded. And you have 70 million tons of edible oil being traded, and you have close to 80 million tons of meal is being traded. So if you put them together, you have close to 20% of the global food being produced is being traded across the world. And this is important to know, because then we're going to try to relate to those countries where GMO are being adopted, the percentage of the adoptions being occurred in these countries, and how much actually is being a portion of that production goes into international trade, sir. And which are these countries where these GMO are being consumed, sir? Because generally when you talk to people, they say that it's only very few people on the earth that are being consuming GMO, sir. So in the next slides, I'll just give a perspective about where it started. Started in 1996. As of 2013, the data that we put together, we got around 12% of the total land area, of arable land area, 12% of the total arable land area, 1.5 billion hectares, that are you that are being occupied by GM crops. And which are these GM crops? You have soybean, you got maize, and you can relate them to the crop that we grow here in India, sir. And then you got canola, which is equivalent of mustard. Mustard is not yet being genetically, it being genetically modified, but not being commercialized yet in India. But over the across the world, you look countries which are the major producer of canola, equivalent of mustard, like Canada and Australia, being growing mustard and consuming mustard oil and cakes. Then you have cotton. You got fruit crop, papaya. You got sugar beet, where sugar is being produced. You got squash, sweet corn. Sweet corn is being approved in the United States and being consumed directly by the population there. You got papaya there. And then you got pepper, sweet pepper in China. Tomato, this is grass crop, and you have a poplar tree. So these are the crop. So if you look at the basket of crop which are being consumed by human across the world, these are the crop which are already being genetically modified, approved for cultivation, and in form a major portion of the international trade, which I'm going to describe in the later slide, sir. And these are all commercialized, being cultivated over a large area in the world, sir. And what are the trade that you're looking at? We are looking at around four trades, sir, here. You're looking at insect resistance, that being explained by Dr. Narayanan in the morning. You got herbicide tolerant trades, where you actually producing, you actually helping farmer to bring in efficiency in weed management. And then you have a stacking of both insect resistance and herbicide tolerant. And then you have virus resistance, which is primarily being deployed into papaya and squash. These are the two crops where you have. Rest of the crop will have a combination of insect resistance or herbicide tolerance, or both insect resistance and herbicide tolerance. Which are the crop where GHG is not available at this point in time? So major staple you have is wheat and rice and some of the millets that we have. These are the, you know, you may know about there are 27 countries and we have 175 million hectares of land being planted. But interesting part said here is that across the continent that you see, you have close to 13 countries in North and Latin America. So whole of the Latin America, you pick up this portion, you have countries which are growing genetically modified crops. And both Canada and United States, they are the major leading countries of GM crops. So out of, and then you have around three countries in Africa, Burkina Faso, Sudan, and South Africa. We had a couple of years maize being cultivated in Egypt, which later was dropped by. And then you have five countries in Europe, which are growing BT and BT maize, led by Spain and Portugal. And then you have around six countries in Asia, our neighboring Pakistan, Bangladesh in 2013 approved the commercial cultivation of BT brinjal, which completed 1 year, two season commercial cultivation in Bangladesh. The technology being developed by India, donated to Bangladesh, being approved in Bangladesh and being used by the Bangladeshi farmers. And then you have countries in like Australia, Philippines, and Chinese growing genetically modified crops. So the interesting part is that country like South Africa actually approved the cultivation of BT maize in white maize background, sir, which is being consumed as a staple food for South African communities. Sir. Here, when you look at the adoption, because we're going to see what impact it has on the international trade, grain trade and oil trade. So you look at the adoption percentage. And most of the countries where the GM crop are being approved, the farmer are adopting this technology at the level which is more than 90% in most of the countries. Similar to what we have in India, 95% of BT cotton. So you have United States, if you look at maize, cotton, soybean, canola, sugar beet, alfalfa, all of them are. So in United States, very difficult to really find area where non-GM cotton, soybean, or sugar beet being planted, sir. Similar, you have case of Brazil and Argentina. And sir, important for the house to know that these three countries are the major contributor of international grain trade, oil trade, and meal trade. And most of them actually comes from these principal crops, sir, which have a component of genetic modifications. Then you have Canada, China, of course, South Africa and Australia. In case of China, they're still restricting to cotton, papaya, sweet pepper, tomato and poplar. But interesting fact is that large number of laboratories and institutions are working on crops like rice and maize, And China being largest cultivator of maize, 30 million hectares that being cultivated in China, also dependent still on large quantity of import that they do on GM corn and soybean. So China in 2009 actually issued certificate of safety on BT rice and phytase maize, but it's yet to be commercially approved for cultivation in Chinese in the countryside. So when we look at the total the scenario, global scenario crop wise, we look at soybean. So out of 107 million hectares of soybean being cultivated, sir, you got 79%. So close to 80% is GMO, sir. So which are the countries that are not growing soybean? The one country that I can pinpoint is India. We grow around 8 to 9 million soybean, but we still not producing, we are not utilizing this technology, which are being utilized in the rest of the world. And the fact that our yield level are so low, and we are only exporting fractions of what we are producing in terms of meal, we are importing close to 2 million tons of soya oil from Brazil, Argentina, and other part of the world. And that oil is all genetically modified. So here, you know, we have an issue with competitiveness in soya production, sir, because our farmers are not utilizing the technologies which are available in the world. And we putting them on the risk in terms of competitiveness. Cotton, of course, 70% out of 34 million led by India. In the morning, Ganesan talked about India being now the largest cotton producing country. I would like to say that not only that we are largest cotton producing country, we tripled our cotton production in last 12 years. So from 13 million bales that we used to produce, today we produce 40 million bales. So we tripled. We are the largest exporter of raw cotton in the world. You know, we produce close to 10 lakh bales.
400 lakh bales.
Yeah, so it depends on government restrictions. Sometimes they put trade restrictions, so you have an issue. But most important part, sir, is that one third of the total meal, animal feed that we consume in India, it comes from cotton, sir. One third of the total meal that are being consumed by animal comes from cotton, sir. Cotton seeds. And of course, you know, cotton oil is being mixed. So out of this 40 million bales that we produce, you have 1.3 million ton of cotton oil being extracted, sir. So vegetable oil, sir. So that is a big contribution along to the total oil that we produce, close to 7 to 8 million tons. So when it comes to oil, we need to really know that we are importing oil worth 65,000 crores, sir, annual, sir, every year. 10 million tons, 65,000 crore oil that we are importing. So here we have a real opportunity to introduce this technology in soybean and mustards, which it's not going to help us to really remove the major oil that we are importing, because majority of that oil we import, it comes from palm oil, sir. And that palm oil is still not being, which is being grown in Malaysia and Indonesia, is not non-genetically modified. But we rely, we import around 7 to 8 million tons of palm oil from Malaysia, and rest the oil that we get is canola and soybean, which is genetically modified. And we import around 7 million tons of palm, out of 10 million tons. Out of 10 million tons of total oil that we import, 7 million tons is palm oil. Yeah. Yeah, we are importing soya oil, ma'am, from Australia. Around 2 million tons of soya oil and canola that we are importing is genetically modified, primarily genetically modified. We are consuming it, sir. So if you look at the total consumption of oil in the country, we consume around 17 to 18 million metric tons of oil annually. We produce around 7 to 8 million tons. Rest of them we are importing. And out of that, 1.3 million tons is cotton oil, which is all genetically modified. And we have 2 million tons of soya and canola oil that we're importing. So if you put them together, we are actually consuming close to 3.5 million tons of oil annually, which is genetically modified.
Unlabeled.
Yeah, unlabeled, yes. There's no. And then you have, of course, maize, 32%. And we have an opportunity where this technology can be utilized. From the field trial being conducted in India, when I look at the data, I think we have a real big opportunity to increase our corn productions, because our corn yield level are still 2 metric tons per hectare. Very low. It's below 5 to 6 metric tons of global average. In United States and Brazil, people are actually harvesting close to 10 metric tons per hectare. So we have a big opportunity. The countries where we would see a big growth in adoption of technology would be in corn in the future, sir. So countries like India, China, where you have 30 million hectares under corn, then 30 million hectares in put together African countries. So corn is where we see a real big opportunity. And of course, mustard, where the technology is being now field tested. This season, it's being tested in Delhi and Punjab, where the permission was granted by Ministry of Environment and Forest. There you have a huge opportunity to increase your canola production by mustard production by 10 to 15%, utilizing the heterosis being developed by technology developed by Delhi University. Sir, I'll just take a few more minutes. So when we look at global trade, sir, now, so sir, if out of 4 million ton of the total trade that you have, 2 million ton is wheat and rice, sir. So 50% of the 4 million ton is non-GMO. So 200 million ton you just strike out because there is no GM rice and wheat in the world. The rest of the 2 million ton, which is being traded across the world, sir, it's all genetically modified. And you look at the data. So out of that 200 million ton, which is traded, which is not wheat and rice, you have a maize 100 million ton, oilseed 102 million ton, including soya bean and canola. So when I look at this grain trade here, sir, so globally, if I look at, this is about the maize global corn trade, 100 million ton. Here is the oilseed, primarily soya and canola, global trade. So when I put together this pie of the pie chart, what I look at is that out of 800 million ton of corn being produced in the world, 800 out of 175 million hectare of land, you have 100, that less than 10%, 12% of that is being traded globally, sir. 100 million ton. Sir, out of this 100 million ton, 70% of that 100 million ton is GM corn. Okay, what market you have for conventional seed, which is certified? So there are countries in the world which say we don't need GMO, we want certified non-GM corn. So there is a market of around 6 to 7%, which is certified canola market, certified maize market in the world, non-GM. Okay, but there is also market where they don't care whether it's a certified or not, but they say we want to have a cheapest one. So here you have around 20 million. But if you look at broadly, sir. So 70% of the total grain trade in corn, yes, grain trade in corn is GMO. Now similarly,
he said use about cheapest. Are you saying
that's a conventional corn?
No, are you saying that conventional corn fetches more price in international market?
No, that corn which is really that corn which is certified corn market fetches real more market premium than the yes. That's where you have a certified and but there are very few countries where certified conventional corn is being required. But majority of 70% of corn being traded is genetically modified. And principally, you have three countries, United States, Brazil, and Argentina, which has a major market share in that corn market. We don't have the data anywhere in the world. And no country, the 27 countries are planting this technology, additional 31 countries are importing those products for food and feed. They don't give approval separately. They say food and feed. And we don't know how much is for food and how much is really for the feed. Now. So we have no data on that.
Most of the European countries which don't allow planting of GM seeds allow import of
seeds. Yes. So I'm going to give, so they're importing like. Yeah, so look at the countries like corn. Where does this corn goes? It goes primarily to China, Japan, and rest of the European countries. This corn goes to those part of the world. We as an Indian, we don't import because we are exporting some certain amount of corn. Some year we're producing what we consume for domestic market. If you look at real oil seed crops, soya and canola, where the grain is being traded. Soya grain, so where does soya grain go? I have a slide where I'm going to tell you where it's being consumed. So if you again look at around 215 million tons of total soya and canola being produced in the world, sir, 110 million ton of that soya is being traded across the world, soya and canola. And if you look at this one, sir, this chart, the 90%, more than 90% of that canola grain is being genetically modified in the world, sir. So you're looking at 90% of the total soya and canola grain market is being genetically modified, being imported by 31 countries.
What is the position of this theoretical in the form of feed?
So next slide, I'm going to show you about the oil seed. So this is about the grain. So we have a major portion of the grain which comes from soya and canola in the world is being genetically modified. The couple of articles that I also read says that these countries are not consuming, but facts are very different because you look at the international trade markets, and trade market is the right barometer to really see whether the food produced using genetically modified crops are being consumed or not. And here also, when I looked at the certified conventional market, so out of 110 million ton, we have only 4 million ton which is certified market. So India has to choose where you really want to be, actually. Whether you want to use more and get into that market, or you want to restrict yourself to the limited market that you have for the certified. And then when I look at the edible oil, sir, edible oil, as I said, madam, so again, out of, let's say, 160 million tons of total edible oil being produced, you have 70 million tons being traded. And here you have non-GM and palm oil making a big contribution. So the total portion of the total trade that you have 70 million, close to 15 million ton is genetically modified. Okay? The rest of them would be palm oil. But the scenario would be very different when you actually look at the meat segment, animal feed segment. So when you look at now animal feed segment, so you got around 80 million tons of meal being traded. Primarily, 57 million tons is you have the genetically modified soya meals in the world. And rest of them would be canola, again genetically modified, and genetically modified cotton meal. Now it's very interesting, I was verifying this fact with Dr. Mai yesterday, that out of 15 million tons of meal that we produce, cotton meal, 15 million tons cotton meal that we produce, 25 million bales of cotton that we produce, and roughly 1.2 million tons of edible cotton oil that we produce. You know, we are not big into the cotton meal trade, because cotton meal trade is very limited in the world. And the fact that cotton meal is generally, actually in those countries where it's being produced, it's being domestically consumed. And you have a lot of trade restrictions on meal because of the gossipul component that you have in cotton. So there's a lot of technical trade barrier to the real trade of cotton. So here is the real situations that we have in the world trade markets. So if you look at the very limited 18-year period experience that we have with genetically modified crops, you already have international trade which is being dominated in terms of grain, in terms of oil, and in terms of feed with genetically modified. Sir, one last slide. Here, when I look at, a lot of people say that it's only gets into the animal feed. But if you really look at, because you know grains are being traded, and then you have, of course, oil and meal, you may say that there is no fractions of GM in that component. But when you look at the trade of that 100 million tons of grain trade, you have a grain trade of soybean, cotton, maize, and canola. So where it's being used? So I can take an example of Japan. You know, tofu is their very important, you know, food there. And they use actually soya as a principal, you know, ingredient for producing tofu. And then you have soya flour, meal, tofu, soya milk, soya drink, soya flakes. It's being utilized in those countries where being produced in this format directly and in this format indirectly. And this applies to corn. So you have sweet corn, of course, but in terms of normal corn, you have corn flour, corn flakes, corn snacks, polenta, tortilla, popcorn. So if you go to Brazil or UK, Mexico, you say you want to consume tortilla, you have all the chances that tortilla is being produced using genetically modified corn. And then you have fresh fruit like squash and papaya. 99% of the US sugar market is with genetically modified sugar beet. So all the sugar that US is producing is genetically modified. It being extracted from genetically modified sugar beet. And then you have sweet corn in US. So you can really buy sweet corn, which is genetically modified in the United States, America. And you have, of course, sweet pepper. And the last one that I put here is brinjal, because it's being approved for cultivation last year, October 2013. The first cultivation season began on 21st January 2014. And interestingly, the Minister of Agriculture herself, actually, she distributed seedling of BT brinjal, taking a pride that I'm giving better quality material to their farmers. And it was actually witnessed by the global media community also, because she invited a press conference where she distributed BT brinjal seedlings. So here is the little perspective about implication of this technology. Thank you.
Sir, can I just want to add to this just one sentence only, that the difference between producing 1 million tons of soya oil in India and importing 1 million tons of soya oil is that we are missing out on 1 million tons of cake production. So when you import oil, you are not producing cake. If an Indian farmer has the opportunity to produce that oil, he will also produce the equal amount of cake, which goes for animal feed. And we are a protein deficient country. This will be a great boon for the protein supply. Yeah.
Can
sir,
I start?
These data, sir, one second. These data, it's on my data. I have used multiple sources, OECD, FAO, USDA, ADB, different sources that I put together in the
yeah,
press.
Mike, please.
And these are the realistic and...
Sir, Mike,
really
Mike.
If you really attach value, that international trade value, to grain and oil and meal, it would be enormous. It would be very, but I was just asked to give a very brief presentation about how much is being cultivated and what goes into the trade. And so that's where you have a
thank you.
Presentation. Thank you.
Can I go to the next session? Yeah. So there is some rescheduling of the sessions. Dr. Vashne is here and he has to leave for some early for his flight. So I have scheduled GM food now, and we will be having approval mechanism in the next session. So right now I request Dr. Vashne, and also request Mohini Mohanji to be coordinator. I will take you. And please speak in the mic so it gets recorded.
Friends,
friends, Honorable Dr. C.D. Mai, my friend Shri Dinesh Kulkarni, Ravinji, and all of you. My sole purpose of participation in today's conference was that it is not only the crops, but GM is also affecting the animal sectors. In the last lecture it was very widely explained that so much of the feed is coming. That is the reason that feed is also coming, and some of the pharmaceutical medicines which are of the animal origin, they are also coming from genetically engineered animals. And therefore, while we are talking of the policy, we must think up of a wider view that for the whole society, it is not only the crops, but even animal products and some of the medicines which are being produced, they will also have to be thought of. My university is very new, it is only 6 months old, and therefore I am totally busy in the developmental aspect of my university. But still, my scientist brought me to this conference. I am presenting before you the data and the work which has not been done at my university, because I am very new. The whole data has been collected from the different sources, and on that a small presentation is being made to you. Livestock fed with GM crops since 1996. Second thing, GM crops used are GM soybean, maize, rapeseed and cotton. It is already explained by earlier work. 35 million ton of GM soybean meal used in livestock industry, and 65 million ton of GM corn grains used in livestock industry. WHO 1993 concluded that there is no inherent risk in consuming DNA, including that from GM crops, because in the animal gut, number of bacteria are there, and the whole process which is going on in that, the ultimately the modified DNA, it doesn't remain. And therefore, there is no particular risk in the DNA consumption in animals. Feeding GM crops for large animals, that is several studies concluded that GM feed ingredients are nutritionally equivalent to their isogenic non-GM counterparts. In small animals, digestion of plant material and release of transgenic DNA in degraded form is leading to no subsequent absorption. In poultry, in fact, foreign protein from GM crops would not get into the tissue of the food anymore. But basically world is a small life, so in how many generations subsequently it can reflect, it's not known. But presently whatever tissues were analyzed and from that it was seen, there was no protein which is transferred from GM crop to the animal tissue. In fisheries also, GM crops did not interfere the economical traits of the fisheries. Overall composition of GM crops engineered for insect resistance or herbicide tolerance have been essentially indistinguishable from their conventional counterparts, even though their safety aspects require more number of long-term studies. My whole emphasis is for this part, that these all things need a long-term study first. To conclude, from ongoing literature, GM crops are equally or more beneficial to livestock as compared to normal crops. However, long-term safety studies are required from environmental point of view. Today, many pharmaceutical drugs used to treat illness have come from genetically modified or transgenic animals. Genetically engineered animals provide important source of such protein drugs, such as production of recombinant protein in the milk, blood or eggs of transgenic animals, that is cows, chickens, pigs and goats.
Can you give some example?
I'm going ahead. Yes, sir. The pharmaceutical drugs which are coming, it is anti-blood thinning protein to fight blood clotting diseases. 30 goats were engineered and from that the whole drug was produced. We are consuming insulin and the insulin is coming from cows which are genetically engineered. As far as pharmaceutical production is concerned, it is essential that if it is required, it can be genetically engineered. And from that it can be produced. Lactoferrin, that is breast milk supplement for the nascent children, again it comes from cows which are genetically modified. Polyclonal infections, antibodies to treat viral, bacterial, autoimmune, organ transplant, rejection, cancer. This whole again has been developed from cow. Again, that was also genetically modified. Anti-cancer drugs, it is coming from chickens. And erythropoietin, primary regulator of red blood cells, it is coming from sheep as well as from cow. Sir, a lot of people, mainly animal rights activists, are concerned about genetically modified animals to create therapeutic pharmaceuticals. But I am of the opinion that those medicines which are very much useful for the human being should be produced, and for that much purpose genetic modification in animals should be considered. What are the people concerned about? The confusion between cloning and genetically engineering. I think Dr. Mai has already explained the genetically modified crops. Cloning is that you are producing exactly similar carbon copy of the same thing. We are usually doing in the case of the animal, that is we take the embryo and the embryo is divided into 2 or 4, maximum 4, it cannot go beyond that. If it is divided into 2, you are developing the clones. So clone is exactly similar carbon copy of the same thing. While in genetical engineering, only some part of the gene or DNA is changed and modified with the enzyme. So people are very much afraid of the cloning. I am also of the same opinion that cloning should not be done, it should not be allowed. But as far as the genetically engineering is concerned, it is required in case of the animals where pharmaceuticals are concerned. The morals and ethics concerning the welfare of the animals monitored very closely and is a safe process. Presently, whatever is technology known, under that it is a safe process. Transgenic animals research is still subject to existing regulations governing animal research. My whole conclusion or request is that if there are genetically engineered animals from which the medicines are being produced, that is essential, it should be allowed. Second part, most of the crops which are genetically modified are coming as a feed into the animals, and therefore animal products, they are going into the human being. Long term studies are needed with a combined group, that is group of the medicals, agriculturists, and to that extent animal scientists, so that they can see the long term effect of the technology. Because the technology is beneficial in production or productivity, only on that criteria it should not be accepted. Because many things they seem that okay, today it is very much beneficial, tomorrow it will remain beneficial or not is not known. And therefore my humble submission to the whole house is that experiments should be planned, better data should be collected, and on the basis of that data then we should come to the conclusion. Thank you very much.